Good morning, everybody. How are you this morning?
Good.
Well, welcome to those on our modified live stream. We're still live on Facebook, but we're transmitting a different way this morning, so hopefully you can see it and hear it fine. That's what we would love to have happen, and we know it will. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this morning. Even when we have these little glitches and stuff, it really doesn't matter, Lord, because your hand is in everything, and you're in control, and we just open our hearts up into worship to you. No matter where we are, no matter what we go through, the obstacles, we just really love you, Lord, and we give our worship to you this morning. Let's stand in worship.
Yeah.
Jesus, your love is like no other. And all authority, all victory, Lord, is yours. That love, Lord, your sacrifice on that cross. And we worship you in your power and your glory, Lord. Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, and destined to die, poured out all mankind. And God's own Son, perfect and spotless one.
And I've noticed over the last few weeks, maybe 3-4 weeks, The number of young people, children in our in-person worship service is growing. This is an answer to prayer. Before the shutdown, our children's ministry was vibrant. We had about 30 to 40 children per week that were either in our nursery or children's ministry program. And then it kind of went away. And I wanted to know how sad it made me. I mean, I get it, but it made me sad because I learned a long time ago. Healthy churches have kids running around everywhere, right? Just like healthy families. And so we are excited to have young people and children and babies back into the life of our ministry. So with that, we are going to dismiss for our children's ministry. Anna and Sheila are in the back corner, and you are free to go with them. 3 years old all the way up to fifth grade. They have a wonderful day of ministry planned for you, so you guys can head that way. If you're new to our church and you're not sure about sending your young person to our children's ministry, Anna, before you walk out, can you quick wave a hand? That's Anna. She's our children's director. You can go check out our children's ministry if you'd like. We are going to get back to our signing in and signing out process here soon. We do that with technology. There will be a computer in the hall where we register our kids. And we'll have more about that. But today we have a nice sized group that are going to our children's ministry. That's exciting. Summer ministry for children's ministry looks like this. If it's a nice day, we have a beautiful playground out there. The young people will have a lesson and a snack, but we also allow them time to go out and play on the playground. So that's how our summer ministry works. And then during the school year, we have what we call our normal children's ministry, which is, it may not include playground time, but same thing, it could include a snack. There's always a lesson. There's some kind of an interactive craft or game that they do. And it's social in nature and spiritual, and we're really, really excited about that. So that's how that kind of functions. We have some things happening in the life of the church. Yesterday, we had a men's breakfast. We are wrapped up for June, July, and August. Those will resume in September. However, I'm hearing that there will be some summer activities planned for men's ministry because the guys that have been gathering like two things. Food, which that's a winner, and they like being together. And so if you would like to attend any of our men's ministry events over the summer, we invite you to do that. In addition, there are small groups and some women's ministry things that are happening, so there is details about that in the bulletin. Today, we are going to be collecting two offerings. In fact, in your bulletin, you'll see a larger envelope, and it says benevolence on the front. What that is a fund that has been established by Lifeline. We are in the midst of putting together a team of people from our congregation, and the mission and the purpose of that team will be to pray together and use the money in that fund to give away. It may be a family in need in the neighborhood. It may be a family in need in our church. It may be something happening in the greater community. Let's say we hear that a family is the victim of some kind of tragedy. It could be a fire. It could be a storm-related damage. It could be something occurred in their home that caused them to be displaced. It could be a medical emergency. Whatever that may look like, this group of people will prayerfully consider different opportunities that come before them, and that money will be dispersed as that team sees fit into different needs that we pray will be more local, in the neighborhood, within our congregation, within the immediate area. It doesn't mean they wouldn't support something further out than that, but the mission and vision of it will be local. Food, somebody loses a job, things of that nature. If you're interested in serving on that team, talk to me or talk to Anna. But we're going to receive two offerings today. Financial gifts that are placed in the benevolence envelope, that goes into that account entirely. And then there's smaller Lifeline Church envelopes. That goes into our general fund, which helps pay for ministry costs. So just know that, the benevolence fund, if you're watching online and you're using our online giving platform in Breeze, you can do it two ways. You can give a general fund gift, and then you can give a second gift that is marked benevolence. You just mark that, and we'll make sure that it gets in those notes as well. Let's pray together. Lord, I am thankful to pastor a church that when we look out, we see people from different nations and countries, South America, Africa, European countries, all living together in this place called West Michigan. There could be people that are South American in nature who have lived in this country their whole life, or from Africa that have lived here their whole life, but they have origin or roots in nations other than this land. And all I know is it is beautiful when we're together, because that's what heaven's going to look like. Thank you, Lord, for not just our skin color or our heritage. Thank you for our faith that we have in common, Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. Next week, we are going to celebrate in the life of the church Pentecost Sunday, the coming of the Holy Spirit on people. We who believe in Jesus have the Spirit of God living inside us. Young people, youth, adults, those who call on the name of Jesus are not only saved, but the Spirit of God is in our life, in our body, working on our behalf to bring comfort and strength and encouragement. And boy, do we need that now, Lord. We need comfort and strength and encouragement. It has been hard the last several months. Debates and anger and arguments and fear, a desire for justice, visibly demonstrated in many different ways. Political tension. The Holy Spirit resides in everyone in this room, calls on the name of the Lord. You are not only saved, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit. That is good news today, God. And so I thank you for every single person that's here. May this church be unified by the body and the blood of Christ, where friendship can occur and fellowship and people getting to know one another about their story and their life and their faith, what's going well and what is horribly wrong and everything in between. Give us courage, Lord, so that when we are here, something's different. Not just a good cup of coffee or a good song or an okay sermon, but Lord, the power of God we pray for today. And Lord, we thank you for those in our congregation that maybe some people here don't even know who they are, but for Tom Kaufman, who's recovering from his surgery, and it was extensive, bring healing into his body. For Terry Lozinger, who was through a 9-hour surgery the other day on his back to remove bacteria and infection near his spine. 9 hours. And as I began my morning in prayer, Terry texted my phone. I'm sitting up in bed, and I'm feeling okay. We thank you for that, Lord. Be with those that are grieving and struggling, Lord. Bring comfort and peace. Those that are making important decisions right now in their life, if they don't know what to do, give them the courage and the power to do nothing until you speak into their life. Where there is grief and sadness, bring people who love you around them to listen, to care, and to comfort. And as we worship you today, Lord, we do it in spirit and in truth, thanking God for the hope we have in Christ. And all of God's people said, amen. We are going to take a moment and do what we call halftime, which is an opportunity. Our restrooms are down the hall on the left. We are full of Panera Bread today. Good news. If you haven't been here before, we actually get up and we enjoy some Panera Bread right in our service. We have hot and cold beverages to drink, coffee, and I believe some water and juices. And then we'll start our teaching time here in a couple minutes. And we will also receive our offering during this time, either online through Greece or right here in this basket. So go ahead and stretch your legs. We'll start our teaching time in a couple minutes. Thank you.
Second one today.
Oh, not me. When I think of Jim, I think of that tan coat.
So I'm going to preach from two different passages, maybe very familiar on one, maybe not so familiar on the other. The first one's going to come from Acts chapter 1, as we are going to celebrate Pentecost next Sunday. You will see, because our faithful sanctuary decorators will have a red cloth on our cross for next week. And I know that this is, I'm not reminding them, they will remember this in the life of the church calendar, and the Holy Spirit red being like tongues of fire in Scripture is the visual image of the Spirit of God. And more than one occasion, the Holy Spirit coming upon people. We see that in different places in Scripture. And so more than just celebrating that next Sunday, I want to tell you, we're going to share communion together next Sunday, as well as at the end of the service, we're going to have an opportunity, if you want to participate or be involved with a prayer, simply doing exactly what Scripture itself says in terms of praying for people. You see two things. In Scripture, the laying on of hands So literally just putting your hands on someone's shoulder, right? And then praying for them in the name of Jesus. The Bible says that a powerful prayer, where two people or more agree in a prayer, it's powerful and it's effective, right? And so there's a whole, that's a whole sermon in and of itself. But next Sunday, praying for anyone to not only have the Holy Spirit in their life, but activate it. And so here's what you won't hear me pray. If you believe in Jesus, I don't have to pray for the Holy Spirit to be in you. He's already there. So you won't hear me say, "Oh Spirit of God, please come from there, down here, and into them." Because that's not the prayer. The prayer is for the Holy Spirit to actually come up and out of you. Because of Christ, the Spirit is already in you. And so that's a powerful thing that we are going to celebrate. So, you know, it's good to get together to celebrate and memorialize and remember different things. That's not what next Sunday really is, and I want to tell you that. I want to tell you that next Sunday, Pentecost Sunday, is the day that we celebrate and remember the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, but we live 2,000 years after Christ walked this earth. We are going to give an opportunity for prayer for the Holy Spirit to come up and out of people. Now, if you're thinking, whoa, is that going to get like weird and like loud, and are you going to like make the lights go all crazy? Come on, let people come about as normal as they come. I'm a normal dude. It's not going to be like that, but I'll tell you what it will be like. I pray that it will be effective and powerful in your life and spiritual. Because I can tell you in my own life, many years ago, 16 years ago now, when my 6 foot almost 5 son, who just sat down, was diagnosed with a blood disease. Did he wave? Is that when you came out? Right? And then a few years later, when Toby was born in 2009, and was diagnosed with the same rare incurable blood disease, that caused me to tailspin into a bad place. I didn't know if I believed in God for a while. I didn't know if I thought that God was punishing my family. Why this rare blood disease for my son? It was not a good time. And I can tell you that through this healing process and really discovering Jesus, one of the most powerful things that happened in my life in 2007 was somebody put their hand on my shoulder and they prayed for me at a place called the Healing Room in Grand Rapids off the East Beltline. Now, was I saved before that day in 2007? Absolutely. I was bought and paid for by the body and blood of Christ. But did something remarkably change in my life when somebody literally just put their hand on my shoulder and prayed in the name of Jesus for the Spirit to come up and out of me? For those of you that know me, I've been a firefighter for 24 years. I still am. I go into conditions of heat that are 700 to 1,000 degrees when a house is on fire. I can tell you and look every one of you in the face and tell you, never before in my life, that day of that prayer, have I ever felt the heat come over my body like the day of that prayer. Did I start acting all crazy? No, I wept. Did it get weird in the lights, and was the guy screaming a language I didn't recognize? No, he prayed it in English. He was a white insurance salesman. That's what he did for a living. He sold insurance. But he loved Jesus. Something changed. Something activated in me that day. And it brought healing and strength and comfort. I can tell you, it changed my life. The Holy Spirit, amen? It wasn't a magic chant. He didn't follow you a formula. He just prayed in the name of Jesus with a hand on my shoulder. And it was awesome. Now, it took over a year for my wife, Emily, to really want that in her life. When I say want that, she had her own grief. She had her own journey she was going through. And she met in a coffee shop with one of my mentors and I. And he talked about Jesus, and she began to weep, and she just said, "I want this healing in my life." And we left the coffee shop and went to my home that we still live in, and we prayed over Emily, and she collapsed on the floor of my kitchen. For several minutes, Emily couldn't stand, and we sat on the floor next to her. Tim Vink, the guy who preached here on Easter Resurrection Sunday, and myself, sat on the floor next to Emily with hands on and just prayed in the name of Jesus. And did healing come instantly? I don't think so, but that was an important day, wasn't it? And it was the Holy Spirit. Friends, we don't want you to be like us. We want you to know the one who can change it all. going through some hard times. Some of you have been through some really hard times. Grief, disappointment, anger, division, frustration, confusion. You don't have a child who maybe got diagnosed with hemophilia, but you're going through your own set of circumstances. And all I can tell you is the Spirit of God, oh, He's alive and well. He's alive and well. And what a difference to not just get together to talk about God, what a difference to know Him and His power. Wow. Well, today, we're talking about what was happening before this Pentecost event. Kind of like, almost boring, but not really. We're going to look at some scripture where it's not going to really shatter you that much. And I'm going to read it and you're going to be like, well, that wasn't that great. Well, let's look at it. Because I think there's something that we can glean from the Word of God. If you have your Bible, open up to the book of Acts chapter 1. Now, there is a supernatural event that happens here because the glorified body of Christ is literally taken up into heaven while people are physically watching. I've been alive 48 years. Some of you have been alive a lot longer than that. Some of you guys have been like, you think 48 is almost the end of life, right? And then there's a whole bunch in between. And have any of you ever seen anybody taken up to heaven before your eyes? Quick survey. Kim has? Yeah? Talk about that.
My mother and my grandmother.
Yeah.
They both died while I was with them.
Right.
It's amazing the peace you see on their face.
Right. And yet an earthly body was left here, right? So you watched somebody and you saw something spiritually significant happen. Unbelievably powerful. Absolutely. So now imagine if you watched your loved one and their body go up in front of you. Has anybody seen that? Okay, good. Nobody's lying here because I know that you wouldn't be telling the truth, right? So this event happens in Scripture not to take away in any way what you're talking about because that is a profound spiritual experience. But we actually see in this story that Jesus, in front of their eyes, was taken up into heaven. So Acts chapter 1. In my former book, so just a little Bible history, Luke was a doctor. Right, the disciple, right, the apostle Luke, that's what he did for a living, physician, right? He wrote the Gospel of Luke. Luke also wrote the Gospel, or the Book of Acts. So, if you read the Gospel of Luke, and you read the Book of Acts, same author, same guy. So, he talks about this book, and he talks about this person named Theophilus. Here's the truth. Nobody knows who that is. I don't know who Theophilus is. Bible scholars don't know who Theophilus is. He was somebody who mattered to Luke because Luke talks about him in the Gospel of Luke, and he also talks about Theophilus in the Book of Acts. And so if you're thinking, well, who's Theophilus and I want to know more about him, Google, research, and I think you're going to find out we don't really know much about Theophilus other than he mattered to Luke. In my former book, the Gospel of Luke, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles, the word apostle means messenger, the word disciple means follower. Interesting that we begin to see a new word here. Disciple means I'm following someone, apostle means I'm the messenger for someone. So believe it or not, I know that many people in the church say, hey, I'm a disciple of Jesus. And I'm not here to smack you with a ruler and tell you how awful you are. But I'm going to tell you something. You're actually an apostle. That's who you and I really are. We're messengers for Christ. So the Holy Spirit gave messages to the apostles that he had chosen. After his suffering, he showed himself to these men and women and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. We're talking about Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. And on one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with the water, John the Baptist, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So when they met together, they asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? In other words, Lord, are you going to make, is this the end come? Are you going to do the whole deal? Like, are you going to restore the kingdom? Is it going to be over? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the dates that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all of Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. After Jesus said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. And while they were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. Now, I'm going to stop there. So we have this supernatural event. We have a dead guy who was raised from the dead, spent 40 days with people, appearing to hundreds of people, eating food, appearing behind locked doors. We have Jesus telling them, it is me, I am alive, touch me, give me food to eat. 40 days Jesus does this with hundreds of people. That's why we have the scriptures and eyewitness accounts, where even the biggest agnostics or those who don't believe in Jesus would say, I totally believe during this time period a man named Jesus lived. The facts, the history point to it. I don't believe he was the Son of God, but there was a man named Jesus alive in this time period. So that's a wide road for people. For the church, we believe that Jesus, born of a virgin, was the Son of God. That a baby was conceived in a woman with no sperm. That's the story we believe. So we don't believe in a man. We believe in a divine Son of God, both fully divine and fully human. In college, I wrote a paper called, Did Jesus Have Boogers? I think that's funny, personally. And the answer is yes. Jesus had snot in his nose because he was fully human, but he was fully divine. He knew what it was like to be hungry. He knew what it was like to be sick. He knew what it was like to have a full snot nose. And he knew what it was like to be depressed and sad and lonely and grieved. He knew it all because he was the Son of God. Divine and human. That's important. And what the witnesses are seeing here is Jesus is saying to them, don't leave. Don't leave the city. It's not over. I'm leaving, but it isn't over. You're going to receive the gift my Father promised. The Holy Spirit is going to come. And we're going to talk today about why does that matter? Why does that truly matter in our life? Why is that a game changer? Is the Holy Spirit just there to give like little fuzzies once in a while? Like, what's the role of the Spirit of God? What am I supposed to look for? What am I supposed to anticipate? How do I know? We're going to talk about that. So much of life in 2021, and maybe you don't agree, this is my feeling, and I'm going to go back to this text. So much of our lives today is about movement and going and making and doing. Would you agree?
Yes.
It is all about grinding and performing and bettering and growing and doing and just nonstop movement. And it's pressure, and it's on men, and it's on women, and it's in the workplace, and it's in the neighborhood, and it's in the family. It's with finances, it's with kids, it's with sports, it's with everything. Do you agree? And it's exhausting. Because we get consumed with not only wanting to keep up with everyone else, but we bought into this notion that if we're not doing that, somehow we're doing it wrong. If we're not keeping up with this mainstream movement, so if that's material possessions, if that's a house, if that's a career, if it's not new clothes, if it's the car you drive, or it's what you provide for your children, or the club that costs $3,000 for your kids to play in, or somewhere in between. If it's not a phone, it's this, it's that. And we're going and we're pushing, and there's pressure. What I've learned is that as I've gotten older, that doesn't necessarily change for those that are in their retirement years. Why? Well, how do you know that? You're not retired yet. No, but what I've learned is that facts don't lie. And in the history of our country, more people that are in their 70s and 80s have retired with more debt than in the history of our country. Which means retired people are still spending money they don't have. On what? Stuff. Grandkids. Homes. Cars. Health stuff. There isn't this contentment or this, hey, I've worked my whole life and I'm going to live within this. There's debt, there's pressure, there's house payments for people that are in their 70s or 80s. Wow. So there's this movement. And what I want to talk to you today is actually about waiting. And this isn't really a popular message, not because I'm going to say things that are controversial. It's just, it's going to go against the grain of what you and I experience every day, which is growing in movement, performing, and faster and better. And I'm actually going to talk about something that's completely the opposite today. And it's going to go against the grain, and it's going to be hard because it might feel good for a minute here, but I'm actually asking you not to listen to my message today. I'm actually asking you to prayerfully consider doing what I'm going to say today. Not for me, but because of him, Christ. And I point to an empty cross, because he's not there anymore. He's in heaven. But the Spirit of God has been given to us. So what are in the ingredients of waiting? In two sections, in 14 verses, there's two things that Jesus says. Number one, he says this, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father has promised, which you've heard me speak about. So in other words, we've talked about this, but now I'm asking you to actually do it. You've heard me mention it in the past, but the time has come for you to exercise the waiting. That's what Jesus is saying. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. That's the first thing. In verse 7, this is what Jesus says when the disciples say, or the apostles say, hey, are you going to make everything whole? Are you restoring the kingdom? Is that what you're doing? This is what Jesus says in verse 7. It's not for you to know the times or the dates the Father has set by his own authority. That's verse 7. Now, when somebody tells you it's not for you to know the times or dates that something is going to happen, by default, really, what does that mean? That you have to wait. So two areas of this scripture, Jesus is telling the apostles, you got to wait. You got to wait with the big picture, and you got to wait with the near term right now. Don't leave the city. Wait. Something's coming. Now let's talk about that today. What are the key points to waiting? What are the ingredients? What do we need to really understand today? What is the value of waiting? Well, I want to list four things. Pretty quick, pretty easy. Right? The firefighter in me always keeps it pretty practical in training. That's how I preach. I want you to literally get your mind around what I'm saying so that you don't just go home and think, oh, good sermon, bad sermon. Oh, he was on today. That was terrible. Right? That's not why I do this. I literally want you to understand that in your most difficult moments that I have lived in my own life, in my own context, Jesus is not an idea. He is alive and well. The Holy Spirit isn't just some little blowing in the wind, little whispery, spiritual, mystical thing. The Spirit of God literally is in you. And it can be a game changer. on your worst day, in your worst moment, when you're not even sure if you want to be here anymore, it can change everything. Number one, what do you have to really know in waiting? You got to know this. You've got to believe in your spirit that God is the only one who really knows the bigger picture. You've got to believe it to the core who you are. God is the only one who really knows the bigger picture. See, back in 2005, I didn't believe it. And so I spiraled. Because I couldn't believe in a God who gives little boys blood diseases. And I welled up with anger. So not only did it move me further away from God, I didn't believe that God is the only one who really knows the bigger picture. And see, I can't take that away from you today. Because I'm not Christ. And you want to know what? Nobody took it away from me back in 2005 and 6. Did people try to comfort me? Sure. Did people try to love me? Oh, no doubt. But it was inside me. That's where the battle raged. And it wasn't until outside of Missouri, outside of Chicago, Kevin's favorite city, the worst traffic jam I've ever sat in, Chicago, right? Where I broke. And I got so angry at God. You and I, all of us in here, most of us, right, there might be a few, we pretty much know every swear word that the English language has invented. I said them all about 1,000 times in a rental car. And I let him know exactly what I thought of him in that rental car. Why? Because Ryan was in the hospital in Grand Rapids, and I thought he was going to need to have emergency surgery on his spine. And I was going on a mission trip to serve God after a hurricane in Louisiana. And you want to know why I was angry? Because I was going to serve God in Louisiana. Why is my boy in the hospital having emergency surgery on his spine because of a blood disease? That's who you are, and that's when I let him have it. And I broke in that car. And all I remember is looking out the window, and a lady was looking at me horrified by what she saw. Because it looked like a demon possession was happening in that car. I was trying to rip the steering wheel out of the column. I was so angry. Do you want to know what song was playing on the radio? I Will Praise You in the Storm by Casting Crowns. And I can't even say it without getting covered in goosebumps. And I heard the voice of God in the most powerful way in my life. And it was a very simple question. Do you trust me? Do you trust me with yourself? And the answer that I had at that moment was, no, I don't. I didn't believe that God is the one who knows the bigger picture. And in the waiting, I didn't go from unsaved to saved. I was saved. I went from unhealed and angry and wounded to healed, filled with the Spirit of God. It took over a year. It was almost 2. But it changed my life. That's why I can preach this message in 2021 and I don't cry anymore. It's not because I don't remember what it was like to be in that rental car. It seems like yesterday. Now he's taller than me. And then my youngest is going to be taller than me. It's because I've healed. The Lord has come in and he's healed me. And the conversations and the ministry and the tears we've had in our family over this, over the years, amazing. You've got to believe that God is the one who knows the bigger picture. Times, dates, the bigger vision, we don't know. But he does. You got to believe that to your core. And you may be sitting here thinking, I've never gone through anything like you're describing, and I hope I never do. And I hope you never do either. But you might. Or you may know somebody, and you are an apostle. You are a messenger of Christ. And so you may not have something like that happen to you, but you may know people who are going through deeply difficult and hard circumstances. And so the Spirit of God covers it all. Number two, We need to stay connected to God. You know, as angry as what I was, I did stay connected to God. I wasn't sure what I believed or how I believed, but I didn't leave the ministry. There was times I wanted to. I talked to my governing board over a decade ago about whether or not I should just resign. I wasn't even sure I should be a pastor during those days because I was so confused. I didn't know what I was doing. But there was a connectedness to God. This isn't a theory. I'm saying literally, stay connected to God. I don't care how ugly it is. I don't care how imperfect it is. I don't care how unholy it feels. Stay connected to God. I have a peace that when I get to heaven someday, it isn't going to be like the good Lord's going, wow, we kind of got to talk about that rental car experience outside of Chicago. That was brutal, Rob. I'm going to let you in, but man, I'm going to have to kind of punish you for that. That was, you shouldn't have done that. I don't have to ever worry about that. Why? Because he paid for it. Christ would rather have all of me than part of me playing fake in a pew. God isn't interested in whether or not I know stories about him. He wants to know, do I really believe in him? Right? I bought into a theology, born and raised in West Michigan, for those of you that don't know. Kevin and I graduated from Jefferson High School, same year, 1991. We were neighborhood buddies. We grew up a street apart when we were really little. Then he moved away and I got angry, so then we followed him. Then we moved a street away to that house, right? That's the joke we always tell. We're just two public school graduates. Kevin was a church planter in Chicago and went to Moody and went to school there and fell in love with the city and settled there. I've done ministry in West Michigan my whole life. Met Emily in college. She's from Gaylord. That's my contacts. I grew up with a theology that when you serve God and you're doing the right thing, God's going to bless you, which means life's just going to always be easy. Yeah, that's not what it says in here, friends. But that's what I bought into. I do my part, you do your part. I go to church, you do your part to make things easy. I serve you, you serve me. Oops, whoa. And that's not what happened. And I've learned that in the waiting, that's where he does his most powerful work. Oh, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit? We're going to talk about that next Sunday. Unbelievable. But don't skip over this. There's power in the waiting. The pastor who married Emily and I, Dave, he baptized the girls when I was serving as a youth pastor in Zealand. And he also officiated our wedding. And I'll never forget two things he said to me when I was engaged. And I'll never forget something he said to us when we were pregnant for Ashley and Haley. But there's two things he said. This is what he said to us when we were engaged. Don't be in such a rush to get to your wedding day that you miss the joy of being engaged. That was so good. And then he looked at us and said, don't strive to get to the day where your child is born, the birthday. It's awesome. Don't get me wrong. He goes, don't miss the joy of the pregnancy. He's in his 80s now. We saw him in Costco a little while back. And it was a tearful reunion. Powerful, powerful man in my life. You hear the wisdom in what he's saying? The waiting can be just as much is the event. But you gotta look for it. Stay connected to God. Believe that he is the one who has the bigger picture. Number three, remember what Jesus said to the apostles. The reason why you and I are alive and we are not in heaven is specific and purposeful. We are to be witnesses of Christ in the world. So whether that is in your family or in the marketplace or your neighborhood, whether that is walking around town or to children or nieces, nephews, and cousins, aunts and uncles, we are to be witnesses for Christ. So let me ask you, what has Christ done for you? What has he done in you? And do you talk about it? Because when you go to a really cool restaurant, well, not that we've done that in a while, right? You can't talk about it fast enough. When you buy a new piece of technology and you love it, who do you tell? Well, you tell everyone. You post, you tweet, you text, you send it to the ends of the earth. Witnesses of Christ means something has happened that you believe in. Remember, that is who we are. We are apostles. We are messengers of Christ to what we've witnessed. I'm telling you what happened in my life in 2007 when I wasn't even a pastor in this city. Because it happened. I lived it. I was there. You weren't out in that traffic jam with me outside of Chicago, but I hope I painted a picture for you today. It's almost like you were in the car with me, because that's what it was like. That's what it was like. It was that raw. It was that hard. It was that angry. It was that honest. And the most powerful question that the Lord could have ever asked me, he asked me, do you trust me with him? Oh my gosh, I broke. Do you trust him with where you're at today? Because it's in the waiting that you will experience the power of God. Number four, remember this, and I hope this takes the pressure off you, because it takes the pressure off of me. You cannot do this without the Holy Spirit. You cannot do this without the Spirit of God in your life. You can't. I'm not asking you to do something intellectual today. I know that you are smart, talented, gifted people. I get it, and I believe that. I'm not appealing to your intellect. I am trying to awaken the Spirit in you. He's there. The more we try to do it under our own power, our own understanding, our own intellect, that is when it doesn't work. Has anybody ever tried that in your life and it didn't work? Anybody else have the courage to work? Yep, thank you. A few. Right? So three honest people, the rest are kind of fibbing. Good. All right. Okay, well, I'm just teasing. You know, when you do that, it's hard. It's hard. So difficult. You can't do it without the Holy Spirit. You can't. It isn't going to work. That should be good news to you today, not bad. That should bring you comfort, strength, and encouragement, and not threatening. And if you feel threatened, is that from heaven or is that from hell? If you feel threatened, is that thought from heaven or hell?
Hell.
Hell. Because anything that leads you into the power and the presence of Christ is from him. Anything that feels threatening to you and divisive to you and like, oh, I'm not going to have power, I'm not going to have control, that isn't from the Savior, it's from the deceiver. That's where that's from. Yes, you have a body, you have a spirit. And if you don't think the evil one is aware of your spirit, come on. He does. But what my mentors have helped me realize is the devil is not 10 foot with big gnarly teeth and unbelievably big muscles. He's a weak little mouse. Because he couldn't stop the resurrection. Amen? He didn't stop Jesus from being raised again from the dead, and he isn't going to stop where you're going to spend your eternity. Amen? He ain't going to stop nothing. He didn't stop me from being saved in Christ. He didn't stop me from healing. He didn't stop me from being able to preach messages 16 years after some of the most difficult days of my life on this planet existed. Why? What's the difference? The Spirit of God. Christ has nothing to do with the fact that I'm a pastor. It has everything to do with Jesus. It has everything to do with his Holy Spirit. You can't do this without the Spirit of God. So Jesus preaches his most powerful sermon, closing, on this mountain where thousands of people are gathered. And they are oppressed, they are poor, and they are enslaved. They are not rich, they are not the wealthy, and they're not the people in the leadership positions in their town. They're not the movers and the shakers. They're not the ones who make it happen. They're not the ones who are in the mainstream. And he says these words to them from Matthew 6. Why would he say this? This is what he says. Therefore, I tell you, in your poverty, this is my words, Mark. You're not in the mainstream. You're poor. You're oppressed. There's people doing things to you that are wrong and unjust. This is what Jesus says. Therefore, I tell you today, do not worry about your life, about what you will eat or drink, about your body, or about what you're going to wear. Your life is more important than food, and your body is more important than clothes. Look at the birds of the air that we can all hear. They don't sow or reap or store away food in barns. And yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they are? Can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about your clothes? Some would say that that means possessions as well. See how the flowers of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and gone tomorrow, and it's thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you? So do not worry saying, what shall I eat, or what shall I drink, or what shall I wear? Pagans run after these things. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them. So seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Friends, my prayer today for us as a church, you as an individual, as families, as we re-engage in life and in community, my prayer is that you have the hope of Christ as your Savior, and you have the power of his Holy Spirit in your life. And it's in the waiting that God does some of his most powerful work. So you probably aren't going to hear this a lot of places, but you'll hear it from me. When you know that God has you all turned up, you're restless. Don't get busy doing it. Get busy being quiet. And trust. Trust him. He's got the bigger picture. The dates, the times, the details. He's got you. He's got you. Let's pray. So Lord, I pray today. I don't even know why I preach certain messages sometimes, because I think, I don't know. I don't know why you want me to say this. I've had that several times in the last few months where I just don't know. And I've got to believe in my spirit you have purposes and reasons and meanings, because you love these people. You love me. You are alive and well. You are working during a very difficult time in our country with this pandemic and this world, with so many other issues going on. You're working, and I see a whole bunch of people doing a whole bunch of stuff. And we debate it, and we argue about it, and we take sides. And I look at your word, and I see the power in the waiting. So, Lord, take this message and use it for your glory. If there's one person in this room that needed to hear this today, that I praise you for, to really believe you have the bigger picture, to remember that we are your witnesses. What are you doing in our life that we're witness to? To remember we're messengers. And that in the waiting you do some of your most powerful work. Help these people today, Lord, leave this place and those that are watching with comfort, with strength, and encouragement. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Have a good afternoon.